Here are the faces of today's honored patriots. 60 years ago, we British described these very people as murder gangs, rats, vermin, etc., etc. You are now looking at some of the Irish people who personally persuaded the British imperial power after 750 years of occupation to leave that part of their small island, which is today's Republic of Ireland. They have something to say. They hope that their words will help us to understand the Irish question.
We don't pretend to be one voice. We're one people with many voices. And there are many who have different views. But we're an ancient people who had a civilization of 1,000 years and our own laws, which were overturned.
Maura Comerford, patriot and activist for the Irish Republican Army.
The two countries started with similar populations, only about 2 or 3 million between them. But the British policy has made my country small and kept my country the only one in Europe which is denuded of population, which has, until recently, a shrinking population, while their own population has soared. And we have been retained as their servants and their suppliers of soldiers or labourers.
The circumstances of the time were that the British government, in filling its appointments here in this country, brought in people mostly from England, but from the other parts of Britain, from Scotland, Wales, and very few Irish people had a chance of getting appointments in their own country. So that education was geared mostly for export, and quite a number of the young men of my day, when they didn't go abroad, mainly went to the British colonies. Those who had lesser education, of course, went to the United States or to Canada.
Joseph Sweeney, sometime fighter for the Irish Republican Army, today a retired Major General of the Irish Army.
Would you explain to me, Sean, as fully as possible, why you felt compelled to take action against Britain all those years ago?
Well, I don't consider it so much action against Britain as action for Ireland, for the liberation of Ireland. My principal activity was on the intelligence side. And I had the great good fortune to work for Michael Collins, who was our great man of that movement.
Sean Kavanagh, secret agent for the Irish Republican Army.
Can I ask you, at this stage, if you can throw your mind back, what were your personal emotions that compelled you to become an activist?
What we heard at home from our parents' tradition, father and grandfather and friends and neighbors, that tradition came down every year, every generation. And the school teachers at the time were very actively engaged in teaching history. And Irish history is a tragic history. And if you were an Irishman, just like if you were a native of any country, you love your own country. And people are prepared to make sacrifices for the right to live and to govern their own country.
John O'Sullivan, sometime fighter in the Irish Republican Army, now senior member of the Dáil, the Irish Parliament, from County Cork.
Dr. Thornton, would you please explain to me as fully as possible why you felt compelled to get rid of the British presence here in Ireland?
Because I felt they had no right or reason here. We were a separate island, and we felt we owned it, and we should own it, and no intruder or, what, I don't know what other word to use, could or should have any act or part in it.
Breed Thornton, a sometime activist for the Irish Republican Army, today a doctor of medicine.
I was always imbued with that spirit that England had no right whatever here, and we wanted at some day or stage to get them out. They were invaders, and we felt that England took up a great attitude of the dreadful doings of the Germans when they occupied Belgium. And I began to feel, and we did in school, why were they here? That there was no reason for them to be invading, to have invaded Ireland and have remained so long.
Would you tell me, Sean, how you first got involved?
The Countess Markovitz said, why should a British Boy Scout movement be organised here to recruit Irish boys? So she formed an organisation known as Fianna Éireann, the Irish National Boy Scout Organisation. And it took very well. There was companies in the north side of the city and in the south side. Sean Houston was in charge in the north side. He was executed in 1916. And Con Colbert was in charge of the south side. And he was executed in 1916. But it was not until 1913, 4 years after Madam's Boy Scout movement had started, that I went to join.
Sean Harling, who joined the activists of Ireland at a very early age.
Sir, would you explain to me as fully as possible why you felt compelled to take action against the British presence here in Ireland all those years ago?
Because from my very earliest childhood, I had heard both in song and story tales of the brutal oppression to which we were subjected to, both in religious bigotry and for military oppression too.
Martin Walton, a sometime gunman for the Irish Republican Army, today Ireland's leading music publisher.
So I applied for the Dublin Police. My father didn't want me to leave the place at all. And he burdened the papers when they came from Dublin Castle.
Why didn't he want you to join the police?
I don't really know. He wanted me to stop at home growing up to be a vegetable. But I wanted to shake the dust of the place off my feet. I wanted to find the streets paved with gold. I'm looking for them still, by the way. So I applied to a neighbour. And I gave a neighbour's address. And the papers came down from Dublin Castle again. So I found myself on the way to Dublin for a medical examination. My father gave me £5, all the wealth he could spare. So I took off on the old slow-moving train from West Limerick, which is down the south-west of Ireland, landed in Dublin.
David Nelligan, who joined the British Dublin Police, but who, in fact, was soon serving the Irish Republican Army.
So the following day I was sworn into the DMP, the Dublin Police.
Colonel Nelligan is one of Ireland's most famous secret double agents.
I saw past the orderly room, and there was a communique up, and it told of this rising in Dublin, and it told of the executions of men whose names I never had heard, Clark, Pierce, Connolly, and the rest of them. Naturally enough, I would have been at the time about 18. I wondered what it was all about and what happened, and of course I got the British side of it. But what struck me first was the long drawn out time they took between executions, one day, two days afterwards, and so on. And that put me thinking, of course, at that time I had no conception of Irish nationality. And I was brought up in a period of, and school days, I could name every king and queen of Britain or of England, but I knew nothing about any of our own past people because it was definitely excluded from all schools. Not alone the national schools, but a Jesuit college that I went to afterwards. In short, the whole country apparently at that period, without I thinking it was in any way extraordinary, was an accepted subject race of Britain.
Commandant General Thomas Barry, one of the most successful guerrilla leaders against the British that Ireland has ever produced. General Barry was a soldier in the British Army when he first heard that some of his compatriots had risen in rebellion in Dublin. It was Easter time in the year 1916.
Edmund Spenser, poet, in the year 1595. England will bring the Irish so low that he shall have no heart nor ability to endure his wretchedness, so pluck him on his knees that he will never be able to stand up again. English order issued from Dublin Castle to English soldiers in Ireland in the year 1642. Wound, kill, and destroy by all the ways and means you may all the Irish rebels, and burn, spoil, waste, consume, and demolish all places, towns, and houses, and all hay and corn there, and kill and destroy all the men inhabiting able to bear arms. Oliver Cromwell, Englishman in Ireland, before leaving in the year 1652. The enemy were about 3,000 strong in the town. I believe we put to the sword the whole number. Incidentally, the Irish enemy were comprised of men, women, and children. But they had one thing in common. They followed the Catholic faith. Oliver Cromwell concluded his dispatch, "I wish that all honest hearts may give the glory of this to God alone, to whom indeed the praise of this mercy belongs." And then Oliver Cromwell sent thousands of Irish women and girls to the West Indies as slaves.
On April the 24th, 1916, Irish schoolteachers, Irish poets, Irish lawyers, and Irish trade unionists rose in armed rebellion against the British power in their country. The fighting centered around this General Post Office here in Dublin. This noble but suicidal Irish revolt became known as the Easter Rebellion. One of the Irish patriots fighting inside the post office was General Sweeney. He was, at that time, a student of engineering.
There were about a dozen of us started off up Abbey Street, And when we were about halfway up Abbey Street, we heard the firing up in the upper O'Connell Street, which was the attack from the post office and the Lancer unit that had come down the street.
British Lancers.
British Lancers, yeah. And eventually we got into the GPO and began the task there of filling mail bags full of coal, mainly dust from the basement, blocking up the windows, and generally getting ready for what was to come.
Yes, when I arrived at Jacob's factory on the Tuesday morning, it was surrounded by a howling mob, roaring at the volunteers inside to come out and get out to France and fight a lot of so-and-so slackers and all this sort of business. And I remember the first blood I ever saw shed was one big, very, very big, tall woman with something very heavy made a bang at me. And just as she lifted her weapon or whatever she had in her hand, one of the volunteers upstairs saw this and he fired. And I just remember seeing her face and head disappear and she went down like a sack. So that was my first baptism of fire.
At that particular time, I was on the northeast side of the GPO up on the roof, and I could see troops moving about freely in the tower of Amiens Street railway station. I reported down to central control below on the ground floor that these people were there and asked would they fire on them. I was told not to, because they were the inner skillings and they might be friendly.
Well, an Irish regiment.
Well, a very short time after that, they indicated their feelings when they opened fire on me with a machine gun. So gradually the troops began to circle in. And on the Wednesday, I think it was, from the rotunda here, the British had mounted howitzers in the back of the hospital grounds, and they began to lob incendiary shells on the GPO. So we dealt with them as best we could with the hoses available. And then the fire became more intense. They began to come oftener, and eventually they shut off the water supply. So we had to retreat from the top of the roof into the lower floor, and we barricaded a window overlooking the top of the street here. A young lad called Sammy Riley, who is now over in caretaker of Columbia University in New York, and myself, we were on sniper duty, and we stopped a lot of movement at the top of the street here, because when they saw the place on fire, they thought they could move in. And that night they brought an armored car that they had built in Inchicore Railway Works around the corner of the then Great Britain Street, as was now Parnell Street, into O'Connell Street, and proceeded to clank on down towards us. So I said to Riley, you take the right aperture, I'll take the left. And we concentrated fire and stopped it. We must have killed the driver or injured somebody, because they stopped there, and eventually at night when all the lights were out, they came along and pulled it back where it came from.
Sean Harling was in the Easter Rebellion. He was 14 years old.
On the Friday, I think it was, I was going across to the Father Matthew Hall at Church Street Chapel with a boy named Howard.
What were you going across there for?
With a dispatch for Pierce Beasley, who was the captain at that time. So when we were halfway across North King Street, Howard shouted, "Oh!" And I grabbed him as he was about to fall. So I pulled him onto the path and run down to the Father Matthew Hall for help, because it was quite close to me. And two volunteers came out with a stretcher, and we took Howard to the Richmond Hospital, quite close by, a 5 minutes walk. So when we got there, the doctor told us he was dead.
How old was he?
Same age as myself.
14?
14, at that time. So I came then to my terrible task. It was me that had to tell his mother.
Dr. Breed Thornton was a schoolgirl and she participated in the fighting.
Saturday morning, louder than all the noise was the silence that descended on the city. Everything seemed to flatten out and go quiet. And few people came in and said the rumour, a rumour of a surrender. And some of the soldiers, have you a hatchet? Have you a hammer? Nobody is going to get my gun anyway. I won't, I'll die. And they began to look out the back to see was there any avenue of escape. You see, it was a little house with a little yard and stone wall outside it, very small area. And they hadn't uniform, you see. They were in mostly in their civilian clothes. Some had a tunic and some had putties and that sort of thing. And some of them gave me addresses and said, will you, when you get out, will you, if we're taken prisoner, will you call to my mother and call to son? I had a whole list of names. And someone gave me a gun and he said, will you keep my revolver? I said, I will. I had a big skirt that somebody had brought me with an enormous pocket on it. It was like one of these aprons the women in Moor Street used to wear with all the money and all the... So I put that in the pocket and kept it. And then towards evening, we did hear that we had surrendered.
And eventually somebody came to us and told us that Pierce had sent out an envoy to negotiate with the British. And about... An hour and a half to 2 hours after that, we were all told to march out onto Moor Street. And we did this by going up to the top house. There's a laneway near that is now called O'Rahilly Parade. And we got out onto this laneway, and as we went out through the backyard of the house, Sean McDermott, who was one of the leaders, addressed us. And he told us that this was only the beginning of the fight, that they would all the leaders would be executed. He said, but it's up to you men to carry it on. And we filed out onto Moor Street. We were lined up there in fours. We were marched right onto O'Connell Street. We were formed into two lines on each side of the street. We marched up to the front, left down all our arms and ammunition, went back to our original places on each side of the street, and officers with notebooks came along and took down our names.
British officers.
And a funny incident happened there. They came along past me and down about three files down, and the officer looked at a fellow, wrote down his name and walked on. So when he had gone a certain distance, one of the fellows said, does that officer know you? That's my brother, he says. So then when that formality was over, we were marched again into a little patch of green in front of the Rotunda Hospital, an oval patch. And we were all made to lie down there. And anybody who put his foot out on the gravel got a whack of a rifle butt or something else. And we were kept there the whole night, and a British officer during the night amused himself by taking out some of the leaders. He took out poor old Tom Clark and stripped him to the buff and made all kinds of disparaging remarks about him. This old man has been at it before, he says, an old Fenian. He has a shop across the street there. And he took several others out, and that officer's name was Lee Wilson. He was subsequently shot in the town of Gorey, where he was a district inspector of the RIC. We were kept there for...
But the IRA shot him later.
Yes.
The leaders of that rebellion, today the honoured inspiration of Irish people, were shot in Kilmainham jail. Dr. Thornton was also held in that infamous prison.
Which was a dismal, dreary, frightening place to be put on a lovely summer evening. We went in and there were officers inside, and a terrible man with a lantern, like one of those things you see in a farmhouse long ago, going out to milk the cows. And he held it up, and they tried to take more details of us, and somebody said, oh, take them up and throw them into the cells, we can't get anything. There's no light in it, you see. So this old fellow said, bring them down here before they go up to the cells. So he marched us down the corridor, a couple of corridors, and he held up the lantern and he said, read that. So we read out, sin no more, lest a worse thing come unto thee. It's into the drop you should be taken. I said, what's that? The scaffold. Well, anyway, we protested and we said we didn't sin. and we were marched up the stairs and up the stairs and thrown three or four into a cell. But we didn't care where we got, so long as we got lying down. We lay on the floor, and we were very exhausted and very tired. But in the morning, I heard a terrible volley of shooting. And I asked the one who came in to us, to me, a Miss McInerney, I said, what was all the shooting this morning? She said, they were shooting some of the men. I didn't know who or what, and I didn't believe it. That day, we were let out for about 10 minutes exercise, and we met a lot of other girls from other, who had been at other centres during the week. And I said to one of them, I heard they were shooting the men. She said, don't you worry, they're not going to shoot any of the men. They'd be too much afraid of America. Well, the next morning, the shooting was on again and again and again. Every morning after that, at about 5 o'clock, I could hear the men marching out, once down by my cell door, and a heavy march and out, and then the volleys. That was very frightening, but I was consoled by what this girl told me. And I asked Miss McInerney again. She said, yes, there were more shot this morning. Well, for months afterwards, I always woke at that hour, and I've never forgotten those volleys. Never.
What was the effect of those executions on Ireland? What was the effect on the people who jeered at you a week or so before?
Well, the people generally in the country had been weaned away from the idea of using physical force, because physical force had failed in the past. And the leaders of the time, that's the late John Redmond, Lord Reston, had persuaded the people that he would, and Parnell, of course, before, had persuaded the people to give them a chance and see what they could get by constitutional means. And people had turned their minds away from fighting. But this brought, Easter week and the executions brought them completely back into the physical force field.
And unified Ireland.
And unified Ireland.
Edmund Burke, Irish Protestant, commented on the new laws that England inflicted on Ireland, quote, that as a machine of wise and elaborate contrivance, and as well fitted for the oppression, impoverishment, and degradation of a people, and the debasement in them of human nature itself, as ever proceeded from the perverted ingenuity of man. Thomas Grattan, Irish Protestant, in the year 1782. We cannot give the people of Ireland a common faith, but we can give them a common interest. So long as we exclude Catholics from natural liberty and the common rights of men, we are not a people. We may triumph over them, but one day, other nations will triumph over us. Wolfe Tone, Irish Protestant, in the year 1798. My principle is to subvert the tyranny of our execrable government, to break the connection with England, the never-failing source of all our political evils, and to assert the independence of my country, to unite the whole people of Ireland, and to substitute the common name of Irishman in place of the denomination of Protestant, Catholic, and Dissenter. The rank and file of the Easter Rebellion were, ironically, shipped to Frongoch prison camp in my Celtic country, Wales. General Sweeney was there.
We set up our own university there, both educational and revolutionary. And from that camp came the hardcore of the subsequent guerrilla war in Ireland.
Who was organizing that at Frongoch, would you say?
Well, Collins was there. He was very active, but he had, at the same time, he had quite a number of others who were equally as active. All the IRB men, of course, were active there.
Irish Republican Brotherhood.
Brotherhood, yes. And We had quite a great good time there among ourselves.
So it could be argued that the emancipation of Ireland was really planned in North Wales.
Well, the continuation of it, yes.
The country was stood at that time with small police barracks. Every few miles, there was a police, a Royal Irish Constabulary barracks. That started off, the Constabulary started off as the Irish Constabulary, but for their zeal during the Fenian Rising, Victoria graciously gave them the term Royal. And they were the eyes and ears. You couldn't travel from Dublin to Swords, that's a distance of 7 miles, without going to 3 RIC. And everybody passing up and down the road was noted carefully. In fact, when Birrell was the Home Secretary, or Chief Secretary at the time here, when he was questioned about the activities of the revolutionary parties, he said, "Nonsense. The Royal Irish Constabulary has Ireland under a microscope."
Prisoners who were in jail, they were astonished when they came home and found the whole country alive and waiting to welcome them. And I was there among the welcoming crowd, and I'm a witness to what happened. It was marvellous to have them home, and it was just supremely extraordinary experience to have the country ready to make them welcome.
Amongst those who returned from imprisonment in Britain was the new Irish leader, Michael Collins. He quickly became the beloved of Ireland, and he inspired the people to fight again. Farmers and clerks versus the British imperial troops and, of course, the notorious Black and Tans.
When we started to reorganise in 1917, Michael Collins said a wonderful thing. He said, "Boys, if we're going to have a revolution, there'll be no traitors this time." And there were none. Or any that appeared were dealt with.
Eliminated.
Eliminated or sent out of the country. Collins never had anybody executed or eliminated that he could possibly avoid. He was not bloodthirsty. Anything but it.
So that night, a man named Joe Riley came to see me. I was staying at a place called the Clarence Hotel. And he brought me down to an old third-rate pub down the city. And we knocked at the private door. And the publican came out and opened the door. And we went up the stairs into an old beer room, smelly of stale beer. And this handsome-looking man was sitting there with an old shabby suit and an old dust coat thrown on the back of a chair. This was the famed Michael Collins. So the man brought me there and introduced me to Joe Riley. And he said, "This is Nelligan up from Limerick." "Oh, yes, Dave," says Collins. "I know all about you." He says, "And your brother and yourself are all right." He meant we were friendly to the revolution. And he says, I have something to ask you. I want you to go back to the police." So I didn't fancy this role at all. So I said to Mr. Collins, "I'll do anything rather than go back to that bloody place, back to Dublin Castle. I'll join a flying column, I'll do anything." "Listen, Dave," says he, we have plenty of men to join flying columns. The British trust you and we trust you. If you want to serve the revolution, go back." He was a very persuasive man and a very magnetic character. So against my better judgment, I went back. I decided to write to the Commissioner, Colonel Johnson. So I went back to the hotel and wrote a letter to Dublin Castle, the Commissioner of the Police, Colonel Edgeworth Johnston, DSO. Very nice fellow he was too. So a G-man came round the next day and told me that the Commissioner wants to see you at 12 o'clock. So I was only a poor devil of a recruit. So I was ushered in before this big shot, DSO. Swords champion of the British Army. He cut a sheep in two with a swipe of his sword. Very nice old fella. So he said to me, "Nelligan, you want to come back?" "Yes, sir," says I, "I do." "Well," he says, why are you coming back?" "Well, sir, say these fellas threaten me." So I produced the threatening letters. So he said to me, "How are things in the south of Ireland, Nelligan?" "Very bad, sir," says I. "The King's writ doesn't run there any longer."
"What is that?"
"The King's writ doesn't run there any longer." This was a headline from the Daily Mail. It read in the train coming up.
The king's writ
doesn't run here anymore.
Yes.
True, true. Ah, see, said it's perfectly right. Tell me, Nilligan, he says, where do you want to go? You can have any division you want in the service. I want to go back to the G Division, sir, says I. All right, he says. There was an old chief inspector of the G Division, an Irishman named Bruton, Tipperary man. And somehow I got an idea at the back of my head that Bruton didn't think that everything was lovely in the garden, but he was too decent a man to suspect that I was a traitor, you see, or a double dealer. And he was always very nice to me. So I started my nefarious career as a double agent.
Is it true, sir, that at that time Michael Collins had £10,000 on his head, dead or alive?
Yes, it was quite true. And one unfortunate man attempted to avail of the chance to earn some easy money. He was the head porter in the Wicklow Hotel. And the day after he passed on the information, he was shot dead in his own cubicle in the Wicklow Hotel. So that Collins had a pretty good line on communications into the castle at that time.
Apart from the fear of getting shot if you did name him, he was a much loved man.
Oh yes, everybody who ever came in contact with him had a great regard for him and would follow him anywhere. He was a man who was prepared to never to send anybody to do something that he wouldn't do himself.
Perhaps the most distinguished Irish leader in the field was Commandant General Tom Barry, at that time 21 years old.
Well, every man that was allowed onto the column was selected to him. And you had good calibre there. You had a fine lot of good, decent Irish men. And you had a lot of brave men there amongst them. And I would say that at least 9 out of 10 of them were prepared to give their life, even though they felt that it would end, like all our struggles, in disaster, but they were going to make the British pay once it started. And I was very, very lucky in the calibre of the men that came under my command. And I made it clear to every man that joined the column, that volunteered for the column, that they'd have to live hard, they'd have to eat when we could get it, they'd have to travel far and fast, they'd have to sleep where they could find it, in a hay barn or in a field. And they weren't to come on unless they accepted that position. And above all, they had to accept the discipline of me, the column commander, and my section commander. And I must say, I never had the slightest bit of trouble with one of them. They're all dead now, nearly. But there were men you could be proud of.
Well, in the paper recently, there was four articles written about an episode that's called an unsolved murder. And it was simply and solely a raid for arms. And the man that was raided for arms happened to be, we didn't know, a British spy. And I never saw a bigger man in my life. He was about 6'3" or 6'4", built in proportion, and I think I was about 18 at the time. And there was a terrible trouble, and he nearly killed two of us, including myself, and we had to shoot him.
How did that happen?
Well, he had deserted his wife, and a tip-off was given by the wife's sister that he had a lot of arms in the house. And in the ordinary course, he was called upon to deliver the arms and at the point of the gun. And, he put up resistance. And when he was dealt with, not shot, not killed, or that, but when he was well dealt with otherwise, And we thought he was all right. He wasn't. He was jumped up and tried to kill us. So in the struggle, he was shot. But it wasn't a question of murder at all. It was the last thing we intended doing. He was offered a receipt for the guns he was in taken from, that he would be paid for them, and that it was a recognised, what we call the recognised government at the time that was gave us the power to do this. No use.
Does that event haunt you?
Not at all, no. There was no intention there, it was pure self-defence.
In the year 1800, the Irish Parliament was extinguished by my country, Britain. Ireland, we stipulated, was henceforth to be ruled from London. It was called the Act of Union. Britain's great liberal leader, William Ewart Gladstone, described that Act of Union with the following words: "There is no blacker or fouler transaction in the history of man. We use the whole civil government of Ireland as an engine of wholesale corruption. We obtain that union against the sense of every class of the community by wholesale bribery and unblushing intimidation."
Patrick Pearse, outside the General Post Office in Dublin on Easter Monday of the year 1916. Irishmen and Irishwomen, in the name of God and of the dead generations from which she receives her old tradition of nationhood, Ireland through us summons her children to her flag and strikes for her freedom. We declare the right of the people of Ireland to the ownership of Ireland and to the unfettered control of Irish destinies to be sovereign and indefeasible.
Roger Casement, before being hanged by the British in the year 1916, Ireland has seen her sons, aye, and her daughters too, suffer from generation to generation, always for the same cause, meeting always the same fate, and always at the hands of England. And always a fresh generation has passed on to withstand the same oppression. If this be the cause I stand here today indicted for and convicted of sustaining, then I stand in a goodly company and a right noble succession.
Men like Thomas Barry and Michael Collins made the British ascendancy in most of Ireland untenable, and this after 800 years of British subjugation of the Irish people. The Welsh Prime Minister of Britain, Lloyd George, called for an Anglo-Irish conference in London. But who in Ireland would travel into the enemy's camp?
Well, he was out in Glenbar in his study, and he told his secretary that he wanted to prepare some documents.
This is Eamon de Valera,
the president. Yeah, for the plenipotentiaries. And he started to pace up and down, as he usually does when he is dictating letters. He can't seem to sit down. He walks back, or walk back and forward, mostly. But on this occasion, he said, "I hereby appoint Art O'Griafot as envoy extraordinary and envoy plenipotentiary from the elected government of the Republic of Ireland."
That's Arthur Griffith.
Yeah, then he got her to do three copies of that. And then he got her to do three copies of one I hereby appoint Micheál O'Coline Envoy Extraordinary and Envoy Plenipotentiary.
Michael Collins.
Yeah, from the elected government of the Irish Republic. Now, he's done the same then with Duggan and Barton and the other plenipotentiary. And there's another one, there was five altogether.
And you were in the room while he dictated?
Yes, I was always in the study mostly at the time. So then he prepared the letters, the documents into envelopes, and I took them into town and gave them to the people individually. But afterwards, De Valera at a cabinet meeting was fighting a claim that they signed the treaty without his authority, and if they promised to come back before they signed, and they didn't. And Arthur Griffith said that they already had that authority in the document that he gave them. But see, did Lloyd George see that document? He didn't even bloody well look at it, Griffith too. And I believe that too, that Lloyd George never seen the document. But that was, of course, their business, you know. But that was the story of the letters, the plenipotentiary letters to England.
Do you think Michael Collins wanted to go to London?
No, he didn't want to go at all. But the cabinet voted him to go, and he just had to go there.
The Irish treaty was signed. That treaty partitioned, cut off, six counties in the northeast of Ireland. These six counties were part of the ancient province of Ulster. This, plus an agreed oath of allegiance to the monarch of England, created the awful, tragic Irish Civil War between so-called Irish Free Staters who supported the treaty and so-called Irish Republicans who rejected the treaty.
Lloyd George, you countryman again. Lloyd George said, sign this or the order goes to the troops for an immediate, and what will be a terrible war.
When the news of the treaty and the details of it were first published, they were accepted by the vast majority of the people. Of course, when De Valera disagreed, would oppose the treaty, that changed a lot of people's minds.
I thought the treaty was a good thing for this country. It was the first chance we got to have our own regime. And then the Civil War started up, as you know. I took Collins's part. And not a single one of the people who were working for Collins beside him. They all lined up on his side. Yeah. I was in the army then. Mm. But I thought that De Valera and his pals should have given Collins a chance to found a state here, still that they made war on us. You know the result yourself. It's going on still.
David Nelligan, Free Stater.
Were you opposed to the treaty, Maura?
Totally opposed to it. It involved taking an oath to the King of England, and had taken an oath already to Dalyra.
Maura Comerford, Republican.
We made our decision and we had to carry on after that. We thought we were right, and I still think we were right. I still think we had the majority of the people, as the polls proved at the time, behind us, and it was a tragic war.
John O'Sullivan, Free Stater.
Three things stood out. Within all the writing that was there, and the signatures and all the rest of it, one was that Ireland was partitioned and that six of our counties were to remain part of British territory. That was number one. that out of the treaty for me and many more people. Number two was there was an oath of allegiance to a foreign king. And that oath of allegiance made us a subject people. And that was what we had been killing Britishers for. And let's make it be clear about this. I'm not one of these that believe that war is a glorious thing. I think it is bestial. And the First World War taught me that. And there's nothing romantic about war. The only war which I can justify to myself is a war of liberation.
Thomas Barry, Republican.
Did you in any way blame the British for that predicament?
I blame them for everything all through my life. All our troubles, we've never had them to blame anybody but them. They were more clever than we, more experienced, and they fooled us to a point. But we could have avoided the Civil War. That was one thing that needn't have happened.
Breed Thornton, Free Stater.
When the Civil War breaks out, it's brother against brother. And there's no saying what way you would go. It all depends on what group you got into. And in my case, when I walked out of the house on that morning, I headed up the road instead of down. Now, had I gone down the road, the first group I would have met would be the Free State, and I would have probably fought with them. If I went up the road, I would be going down towards O'Connell Street to the Republicans, and I would have a fight with them. But my mind wasn't made up as to what I would do until I found myself in the Republican group. So I took part in the Civil War as a Republican.
Sean Harling, who could not make up his mind. Amongst those killed in the awful Civil War was Michael Collins.
We felt stunned. We felt lost without a leader. We felt that the country had got the worst blow any country ever got.
I thought it was the end of the world for me. I couldn't believe it. That alone was it was the worst disaster that had happened to our country up to then.
I was awakened in the early hours of the morning, sometime around 7 o'clock, as far as I remember. And I nearly fell, actually, because not alone was he one of my commanders, but he was a very old friend at that time. And I felt a sense of desolation, because he was the dynamic force behind everything that had happened all during the periods 1920, 21. And I felt terribly depressed. I couldn't see who could step into his shoes. And I could foresee divisions arising out of his going. In fact, before he went to Cork, I met him and I told him I thought he was very foolish to go down there. And his answer was, nobody's going to shoot me in my own county.
I saw a most remarkable thing. There was a thousand of us, 1,000 in prisoners in Kilmainham jail. And I was in one of the top cells with Oscar Traynor, who was OC in the Dublin Brigade at the time. And there was two and three to the cell. We heard the hubbub outside, and we walked out, and if you were ever in a prison, I suppose you were, if ever you were a jailbird, you'd know that there places where the wires right across to prevent poor devils of prisoners from jumping down and finishing it all quick. But I looked down and I saw a most remarkable sight. There was about 700 or 800 men, and they all down on their knees, and they sang the rosary for the repose of the soul of Michael Collins. One time he was their leader against the British. Then he was the commander-in-chief of the enemy forces.
Where were you, sir, when you heard about the death of Michael Collins?
I was ill that week. I was in bed, and when I heard the news...
Can I ask you, Mr. Walton, looking back, where all this suffering and service, where do you hope that it will take Ireland in the future?
All you can do is hope that we'll have sense enough to build a nation, and courage and determination, and all the other virtues or requisites that are required for that.
There is only one thing I hope for Ireland, and that is that some agreement will be made between our people in the north and ourselves. And I hope the British government, who have the more power than anybody else to help in this situation, will come out as soon as possible and try and bridge the gap that is there. I think it's their duty. They inflicted this on the country. I believe that there is goodwill enough among the British people for it. And I know that in the Irish people, that the big majority of the people want peace and progress, and that there is no such thing as an anti-British feeling here. The only feeling we have is that the leaders of British public opinion can still learn the lesson that history should have taught them by this.
I'd like to see an Irish government running the whole country. I don't know how that will come about, but it's my fervent prayer that the shooting and the murders will lay down, and that acts of violence will lay down, because, you know, acts of violence generate one another. When you shoot somebody tonight and his pal shoots you tomorrow night, that goes on circularum. I hope to God, and I pray to God every night, that I see the end of that.
What role?
Terrible.
What role do you see, David, for the Protestants in the northeast in a united Ireland?
The Protestants were always good citizens here. When we set up our own state here, the best citizens were the Protestants. They were law-abiding people, and they still are. And I think they should get a fair hunt, even though they're a minority. They should get a fair hunt, and they will get it from any native government. They have no hope other than that. The stagnation up there, and murder and ructions and shooting and killing women and everything else, I can see no end to that. It's a hopeless business. I hope to God the day will come when they'll have a bit, when every side will have a bit of sense, the IRA and the UDF and the rest of them. They'll settle down, be reconciled to each other, and we're all children of the human race after all. It's really a terrible state of affairs in the 20th century. See mines going off and millions of pounds thrown down the drain for no good. I can see no end to it. I think the British will have to pull out of it. And if they have any sense, they will too. Because there's nothing to be got for England in it. Nothing.
I never take any
make any distinction between a man, what a man's religion is. I meet them on their own terms. I like to judge a man as I meet him. And religion never enters into it. And in these days now, when religious attitudes all around are changing, I don't think there's any great difference between us all.
Yes, because Protestants were the beginning of our democracy. They were beginning of our peace movement. You had Wolfe Tone and the United Irishmen. And Wolfe Tone, a Protestant, well, he was the first Protestant who sat down among Catholics to work towards their emancipation. We can never forget, we have a debt to Protestants and they to us. And I'm very confident that if there was a withdrawal, there would be no bloodbath. It's the presence of the British and their intrigues which make sure that this evil will continue.
And if you go all through our history for the last, let's call it 200 years, there have been some wonderful Protestants. Thomas Davis, the man that I quoted to you there, was a Protestant, Wolfe Tone. Parnell, the man who went before Parnell, Shaw, a completely forgotten man. Isaac Butt, the founder of the Home Rule business. Come down again, Roger Casement, Erskine Childers, all the whole lot, there were any amount of good Protestants. I think in our little company in 1916, there were four Protestants who went out.
Fighting for the emancipation of Ireland.
Yes, fighting, yes, and the volunteers.
Well, I would hope that they would accept citizenship of Ireland under an Irish government in a united Ireland. They're a fine people. And it would be very valuable in the building up of the whole nation.
Well, Kenneth, I'm an old man, I'm in my 80th year, and I don't like pontificating. But I'm as sure as I'm sitting here facing you that we'll never have peace amongst the six county people, are between Britain and Ireland, until the British army of occupation is removed from our island. I'm positive of that. It may now, this thing that's going on, may fail, it may fizzle out, it may be patched up, I do not know, because I have nothing to do with things as they stand. And I believe all men should stand aside and let it to the people who are responsible. But I'm as positive as day follows night, and night follows day, and that rivers flow, that you'll never have peace in this country until the British Army and its administration in the six counties is shifted. And I see the danger there of sectarian warfare. But I believe that both Catholic and Protestant in the North, if the British were out of the way, you may have isolated incidents of madmen, as you will always have. But I have sufficient faith in the good sense of my fellow countrymen in the North that people will settle down and they'll end this sectarian killing. You may have some of it, but in the long run, it will be the one hope for the Irish people.